So I was born in 1975, post-war Germany, second generation. I was an outcast. Other kids didn't want to play with me. I was trying to get an identity. I was trying to find the purpose. Who am I? How do I fit in this world? The one day I was a nice 13, 14 year old, and the next day I came home with a shaved head. Oh my God, what happened? Well, it is still a slow influence, repetitive, that comes in from whatever the trusted sources. In my case, first it was the jokes, then it was the music, and then it was the group of skinheads, then it was the neo-Nazi party that just fed a more radical message. The white people were the only ones that stood in between the Jews and the world domination, that want to wipe out everything to reach their goals. This is how it was presented to us. I climbed up the ranks pretty quick because I always wanted to be somebody. I always was looking for that identity and that purpose. And those groups are giving you that. They give you opportunities to climb up the ladder, to become leaders so you can recruit others. They do that on purpose so they can grow. Fortunately, I never committed any crime that would send me to prison or the prison sentence, but I didn't want to go there for sure. So what I did is I resigned. I gave the office to somebody else. I took the family and we moved to another town. And the only apartment we could find, short notice in another town, was owned by a Muslim immigrant from Turkey. I saw him acting with his family, how he was worrying about his kids, about his wife. He liked the same food as I. He liked music. He liked a good movie. He worried about his future, about his job. These were all things that I did too. And all these commonalities we had, that he had a different accent, a different belief system, that he was an immigrant, even that he was my landlord, that was all not important anymore. Because of these commonalities, they were so much bigger. And all I saw was a human being sitting at the table. And that was powerful. My whole hate, it started crumbling. And then I moved to Memphis. And guess what? I realized all these commonalities were so much bigger than the differences. When Pittsburgh happened, I called my new Jewish friends and asked them, are you okay? But I never felt this feeling that I felt that day. I felt unsafe, because I belong to a certain group of people, in that case, the Jewish people. And that changed a lot for me. And it gave me a great understanding how a minority community, in that case, the Jewish community, feels a helplessness whenever something happens. And might it be only a swastika on campus or on a synagogue, or just minor things like that. And I made it my mission not only to tell my story, but also to find out what can we do to counter this. I see a spike in antisemitism for several reasons. One of the reasons is the internet, because spreading memes and spreading propaganda, antisemitic propaganda, is so much easier. The solution is really education and also listening to individuals and talking to individuals. I call it walk across the cafeteria. We also see them as human beings. Lowers their guards, and they start seeing us as human beings, and a conversation is possible. Whenever we feel as a community, when we feel under attack, when we feel we are helpless, we are numb, we don't know what to do, we have a great power. We have a great power to talk to these people. We have a great power to decide what happens to people when they're in boxes. When other people have labeled them as neo-Nazis, anti-Semites, racists, or whatever the label is. This is the great power we have to decide what is happening to those people in these boxes.
Light one candle for the Maccabee children, with thanks that their light didn't die. And light one candle for the pain they endured, their right to exist was denied. Light one candle for the terrible sacrifice justice and freedom demand. Light one candle for the wisdom to know when the peacemakers' time is at hand.